The next item of business is a statement by Kevin Stewart on Suicide Prevention Strategy and Action Plan. The Minister will take questions at the end of his statement, and so there should be no interventions or interruptions. I call on Kevin Stewart. Up to 10 minutes, Minister.
Presiding Officer, it's important that I start with a simple truth. Every suicide is a tragedy with profound and lasting effects on people's lives. And it is imperative that governments set a clear course to reduce suicide and ensure that anyone affected by suicide is able to get the help that they need. Today, I'm happy to say that a few weeks ago, we launched a document that I believe does just that, the Scottish Government and COSLA's new 10-year suicide prevention strategy. The work around time, space and compassion for those in suicidal crisis has emerged over the last couple of years and now forms a key foundation of our new strategy and action plan. And we understand that we also need to embed these principles right across our work to build compassionate communities and services. Presiding Officer, I must acknowledge that although we launched the strategy and associated three-year action plan last month, the impact of the national period of mourning on parliamentary business meant that this statement could not be made until today. However, I am pleased that we are now able to do so, because key to the strategy is an ambition for everyone to work together to prevent suicide. Members across the chamber know the devastating impact that any death by suicide has for families, for friends and for communities. And whilst the number of those taking their lives has thankfully reduced in each of the last 2 years, we know that there is still much to do to reduce suicide deaths in Scotland. Our aim is for any child, young person or adult who has thoughts of taking their own life or are affected by suicide to get the help they need and feel a sense of hope. Our approach needs to be rooted in the three principles of time, space and compassion across government, across party lines and across all sectors and communities. Putting it simply, we all must do everything that we can to reduce death by suicide in Scotland. And I'd like to thank everyone involved in shaping the strategy, including members in the chamber here today, for the way in which they have positively engaged and supported this work. We have called our new strategy Creating Hope Together. This is absolutely what we need to do to deliver our vision of reducing suicide deaths in Scotland. And we are backing the strategy by doubling annual funding for suicide prevention to £2.8 million by 2025-26. We know that if we are to deliver our vision, we must build on our successes to date, particularly the way in which our approaches have been shaped by the evidence of what works and the views of those with lived experience, including the National Suicide Prevention Leadership Panel, which has been recognised by the World Health Organisation for its work. And I'd like to take this opportunity to again thank the Lived Experience Panel and all those involved in the leadership group for their work. Our new strategy continues to drive forward key actions from Every Life Matters, our previous action plan. That includes our vital work to reduce stigma and grow public awareness of suicide and its prevention, to embed time, space, and compassion into the responses people receive when they are suicidal, both within services and within their communities, and also to support people bereaved by suicide. Crucially, though, we also plan to step up our approach. The strategy and action plan set out a number of new approaches, again guided by insights and evidence, and I'd like to highlight a few of these, Presiding Officer. First of all, this strategy seeks to support anyone affected by suicide, whatever their age or experience. This could be their own experience of suicidal thoughts, caring for someone close to them, or feeling affected by suicide more generally in our society. We know that we will only succeed by supporting everyone affected by suicide. Secondly, we are taking a whole of government and society approach to tackling the inequalities that contribute to suicide. Statistics tell us only too clearly that certain groups are at higher risk of suicide. Deprivation can be a key factor, so it is important that we seek to tackle the social determinants of suicide through policies such as reducing child poverty, tackling homelessness, and funding debt advice. This is all the more important at a time when the cost of living crisis is impacting significantly on so many lives. The third theme within the strategy, which is a strong focus on reaching and supporting people who are at higher risk of suicide as early as we can. In this Parliament, we have recently reflected on the value of initiatives like Men's Sheds in both promoting good mental health and reducing suicide risk. The strategy highlights our aim to take a proactive approach to supporting other groups who may have a higher risk, such as people who are LGBTI or are neurodiverse. We will work with people with lived and professional experience to understand more about how we can connect and support more marginalised groups. This includes how we can remove barriers and ensure that the responses people receive are embodied by the principles of time, space and compassion, and that they are also culturally appropriate. We also wish to focus on the different needs of population groups. For example, both older adults and children and young people may have different needs and types of responses that are suited to them. And we are taking a focused approach right across our work so we have maximum effect in our overall aim to reduce suicide. So the strategy prioritises settings such as prisons and locations of concern, particular communities and parts of the workforce where we feel our efforts can make the biggest difference. We have a very solid baseline of understanding through our work in Scotland over the last two decades and from our first-class academic research. Both of these have been fundamental in shaping the contents of the new strategy and the action plan. That research also reminds us of the importance of sensitive media reporting of suicide, so that is another priority for action. Evidence also tells us that it is crucial that people who are suicidal get the support they need from services. And we know that many people who die by suicide have had contact with statutory services, often health and social care services, leading up to their death. Through this strategy, we want to make sure that whenever someone contacts services, they will be met with compassion and given the support that they need. This support should promote their well-being, protect against suicide, and have a primary focus on recovery. And our work encompasses primary care, mental health, and unscheduled care settings. The final area that I wish to highlight, Presiding Officer, is peer support. One of the strongest messages that we have heard in developing the strategy was the value of people talking to others who have shared their experience of suicide. I have been fortunate to hear first-hand accounts of the value of peer support, both at the launch of the strategy and in countless discussions that I've had with those with lived experience. Peer support clearly gives people a deep connection, which not only offers them personal support, but can help create a path to recovery. And we will seek to embed peer support and recovery models for suicide prevention, working with key partners such as the Scottish Recovery Network. Presiding Officer, in developing this strategy, we have both deepened existing relationships and created new ones. We must continue to nurture those relationships so that we can truly create hope together in our mission to prevent suicide. The strategy and action plan sets out the Scottish Government and COSLA's plans to realise our vision across sectors and bringing our local and national work together in a meaningful way. I will conclude by once again thanking everyone, including members here today, who have contributed to the development of the strategy and the action plan. Across all of our partners, stakeholders and members of all parties, I'd like to thank you all for your efforts. We all have a part to play in preventing suicide, and I very much look forward to seeing the progress that we will make together as we create hope together and make a profound and lasting difference to people's lives. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. The Minister will now take questions on the issues raised in his statement. I intend to allow around 20 minutes for questions, after which we'll move to the next item of business. I'd be grateful if all members who wish to ask a question were to press the request to speak button now. And I call Sue Webber.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I'd like to thank the Minister for advance sight of the statement. I'm sure everyone in the Chamber will be deeply concerned that Scotland has the highest suicide rate in the UK. Last year, 753 Scots took their own lives. That's 753 people who were not given the support that they need. I welcome the new Suicide Prevention Strategy and Action Plan, and like the Minister, thank every organisation, family and individual that's contributed to the development of this plan. Every suicide is preventable, and we owe it to those who have lost their lives and their families to make sure that Scotland's Suicide Prevention Plan is the very best it can be. And while I welcome the doubling of annual funding for the suicide prevention to £2.8 million by 2025-26, it doesn't matter how much money we spend on developing effective suicide prevention interventions when ultimately we know that the most significant barrier to improving mental health nationwide is the lack of well-trained clinicians. We may have the mental health interventions that work, but we lack the workforce or infrastructure to deliver them. A strong suicide prevention strategy requires us to intervene early. Samaritans Scotland have said that the bar is still far too high for accessing support when facing a crisis. More sustainable investment in crisis support is required to promote and deliver 24-hour open access crisis support for those in distress and crisis. So does the Minister agree that the prevention strategy needs to ensure that people are supported before they face such a crisis?
Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And first of all, I'd like to put on the record my thanks to Ms. Webber for engaging with me and with the Government on this issue and helping us create this strategy and action plan. And I agree that we need to do more to ensure that people do not reach crisis point. I disagree with Ms. Webber on some of the points that she's made around about workforce, because we have the largest mental health workforce in these islands, but we still need to do better, and I don't disagree with that point. But I think that we would also all agree that some of the interventions that we need to make are not at the clinical or acute stage. They are in communities, and that is why this government is investing in our children's and adults' community health, mental health and wellbeing funds, which are making a difference in communities right across our country. And what we also need to do is not just rely on that clinical interventions. We, all of us, must do better in helping people when they are at crisis point. I know that there is an ambition from all parties that I've spoken to that we get that right. I will continue to listen right across the chamber to people's views in order that we get those interventions right. And most importantly, I will continue to listen to the voices of lived and living experience. And I know that people across the chamber will do that too.
Carol Mockin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I also thank the Minister for advance sight of his statement. In my own area of East Ayrshire, which is highlighted as one of the places most affected, the key to successful intervention is to work with people early and have properly funded training so that we can embed the concept of suicide prevention throughout every stage of care and treatment. Also, many professionals in primary care require further training to recognise these signs and in doing so bring down the backlog of people waiting for treatment, which is of course concerningly high. Given it does not match previous investment in suicide strategies, I'm going to ask the Cabinet Secretary directly, does he really think that the annual funding of £2.8 million and a rebranding exercise is going to cover the training requirements and the work that we need to put into making this strategy successful?
Minister.
I thank Ms Mohan for her question, and I have to say that £2.8 million for suicide prevention is not the only money that we are spending on training and ensuring that we get this right. And what I would say to Ms Mohan is, for example, the trauma training that is being delivered across the country is absolutely beneficial in getting all of this right for people too. And I would praise, for example, the trauma training champions in South Ayrshire that I met recently, who are making a huge impact. And I would say that the impact that some of these champions are making are changing the way that local authorities are actually creating and advancing policy. And that is important as we move forward. This is something for us all to get right. It is not just that £2.8 million. It is the other investments, including, as I said to, in answer to Ms Weber, the £15 million for children's community mental health and wellbeing funds and £15 million for adults' mental health and wellbeing funds. And we must ensure that we do all that we can with the resource that's available.
I call Emma Roddick to be followed by Sandesh Gulhani.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I wrote to the Minister the day the strategy was published to raise concerns around the collection of GIS mapping data for suicides. Many mental health organisations warn against publishing how and where suicides are completed, as it acts as a how-to on what the most successful route is to complete suicide, which is dangerous for anyone considering it. Can the Minister reassure me and others that if this data is collected, it will not be published or, for example, FOIable to protect the public?
Minister.
Presiding Officer, I know the interest that Emma Roddick has in this particular topic, and I'll respond in more depth there in writing around about some of these issues. But we'll continue to approach our work in locations of concern with the utmost care. I can give assurance that our work will always be designed to safeguard and support individuals at risk as well as wider communities. Any new data collection or intelligence on locations of concern is sensitive, and therefore the sharing of such data will be limited, very limited, to key partners and will not be put in the public domain. And we'll also be taking forward action to support responsible media reporting, as we are very, very conscious of the risks associated with the reporting on suicide, including on this specific and important issue.
I call Sandesh Gulhani to be followed by Michael Mara.
Thank you, Minister. Early prevention is key to a robust strategy of suicide prevention. As a practising GP, I refer people all the time to mental health services, but patients face a very long wait. Many are waiting over 18 weeks for treatment, in part due to staff vacancies. What steps will the Minister take to increase staffing levels within mental health services?
Minister.
Presiding Officer, as I said in my response to Ms Weber, we have more staff in mental health services here in Scotland than other parts of the UK, and we have invested very heavily in our time in office on mental health staffing. But we will go further, and we are at this moment looking at our mental health workforce strategy for the future, which will form part, an essential part, of the mental health and wellbeing strategy, which will be published in the spring of next year. But what I would say is that it is not just about the clinical stages. It is not just about investment in clinical services, and we have to get that right too, but we also need to look at more preventative spend. And that's why this government is spending the money it is on community services, so that we can reach people at a much earlier stage before they hit crisis point. And I'm quite willing to share with members, Dr. Gohani and others, some of the impacts that that investment is making. And I would encourage members to go and visit some of the projects that have benefited from that community funds, because they are making a real impact and helping people from reaching those crisis points.
Michael Marra, to be followed by Colin Beattie.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Minister is well aware of the ongoing and long-term crisis in mental health services in NHS Tayside, which has led to two reports by David Strang, the second of which has been described to me as the worst report in Scottish public life. The conclusions of those reports led to ministers forming the Independent Oversight and Assurance Group on Tayside's mental health services. When will the Parliament see the final report of this group? And can the Minister assure us today that there will be a full debate and government time on the content of that report to help ensure that more lives are not needlessly lost to suicide in Tayside?
Minister.
Presiding Officer, can I say to Mr Marra, I am very well aware of the situation in Tayside. I've spent more time visiting in Tayside than probably any other health board area, in order so that I can see myself some of the difficulties that have been faced. And I put in place the oversight group because I was not happy at some of the responses that we have received from the Tayside Partnership. The oversight group are due to report to me very soon, Presiding Officer. I'm quite happy after they do report to me to have conversations with members around about those findings. I know that Mr Marra will probably ask for such a meeting anyway. Maybe what we can do is provide a briefing for interested members after the report. But can I assure the Chamber that I recognise without doubt the seriousness of the Tayside situation, the fact that many patients and families feel that they have been failed, and we will do better.
Colin Beattie, to be followed by Alex Cole-Hamilton.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Firstly, I would like to express my sincerest condolences to any family who have lost a loved one to suicide. In my constituency, there is some great work being undertaken by organisations such as Chris's House and local football teams such as Bonnyrigg Rose, and they are seeking to address mental health and suicide prevention. Unfortunately, suicide rates in Midlothian, particularly for males, remain high, which is a great worry. Can I ask the Minister what targeted help will be available for areas such as Midlothian, and if he would join me to visit these fantastic organisations in my constituency to see their work?
Minister.
Presiding Officer, I'm always happy to visit organisations that are doing well for their areas, and I'm more than happy to visit Bonnyrigg Rose with Mr Beattie. I think a key element in all of this is the peer support element, which I mentioned in my speech. And these folks are often immense in providing that support. And I think for men in particular, they feel more comfortable in certain environments. And football is doing extremely well in terms of helping with these issues. And if I could give a couple of examples, the Changing Rooms Extra Time project, which is being run with football clubs and Sam H, is doing wonders, and I'm sure the same thing is happening at Bonnyrigg Rose. And I was absolutely delighted to attend a day of suicide prevention work at St Mirren last year, and they have been at the forefront of some of this work, and it is quite immense to hear how well the work that they've been doing has been received by people. And also, on a football-related theme, FC United to Prevent Suicide campaign is absolutely top-notch, and I would urge members to have a look at the work that they are doing.
I'm very keen that we managed to include all members who have requested a question, so I would appreciate short and concise responses and questions. And I call Alex Cole-Hamilton and Claire Adamson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I very much welcome the strategy, as does my party. And if I can draw the Chamber's attention to the last line of the vision outlined in the strategy, it references children and young people, and that's important because last month, devastating statistics from Public Health Scotland revealed that one in four deaths of 5 to 24-year-olds were as a direct result of suicide. This is compared to just 1.2% of those aged over 25. Even more shockingly, the report acknowledged that 5 to 24-year-olds were significantly less likely to have had contact with the healthcare service in the period before their death than people older than them. Can I therefore ask the Minister how the additional funding in the strategy outlined today is going to help specifically to give much-needed help for our young people?
Minister.
Presiding Officer, I think I outlined in my speech that there is going to be much more focus in certain areas, and young people is one of those areas. We must get better in terms of being able to discuss these issues and to take cognizance of what young people have to tell us. And that is one of the reasons why we have established a young people's group with lived experience to guide not only the government but others on where we're getting it right and where we're getting it wrong. I think that they will help us shape what we need to do in order to change our responses and to change services. And I'm sure, like me, that the Chamber would express their gratitude to these young people for coming forward and helping us with all of this work.
Claire Adamson, to be followed by Kenneth Gibson.
Presiding Officer, the Scottish Mental Illness Stigma Study commissioned by CME Scotland found that stigma around mental illness remains pervasive in daily life. Stigma has been identified as a significant factor in suicide. With that in mind, how will the Scottish Government place greater emphasis on the impact of stigma around mental health as part of its new suicide prevention strategy?
Minister.
Presiding Officer, the Scottish Government is providing £1 million of annual funding until 2026 for CME, Scotland's national campaign to stop mental health stigma and discrimination. And we have given them the comfort of that year-on-year funding so that they can continue to build on the good work that they have done. And they obviously carry out a huge amount of work, which includes work with employers around about mentally healthy workplaces, Feels FM, an app to help young people express themselves, and face-to-face work in communities right across Scotland. Tomorrow, Presiding Officer, I'll be attending CME's 20th birthday celebrations in Glasgow, and I'd like to take this opportunity to publicly thank them for their hard work over the last two decades.
Kenneth Gibson, to be followed by Julian Mackay.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. How suicide is reported can make a huge difference to those left behind, not only grieving family members, but others might be impacted, leading to, on occasion, suicide clusters. Does the Minister agree it's important that deaths from suicide, when reported in the media, are done so in a sensitive way without sensationalism? And what discussions has the Scottish Government had with the National Union of Journalists and newspaper proprietors regarding their approach to suicide?
Minister.
I absolutely agree with Mr Gibson. We need sensitive reporting of suicide by the media, both in the printed press and across social media too. Sensitive reporting is absolutely vital to protect bereaved families from further traumatisation and to avoid increased risk of suicide in the wider community. And our action plan sets out our plans to work with the national and local media sector to support responsible media coverage, and we'll start engaging with all in the sector shortly on this important issue. I'd also like to say that I'm pleased to say that in Scotland, the Samaritans are already working hard to support responsible media reporting of suicide and have published guidelines for the sector, and we look forward to building on their valuable work.
Julian Mackay, to be followed by Craig Hoy.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Could the Minister outline, as a result of this strategy, what will be put in place for those people who have had multiple attempts to take their lives, many with complex trauma, and how we can ensure that each of these crisis periods is taken seriously and treated without stigma?
Minister.
Presiding Officer, this is a really important question. And what we need to do in these circumstances for the most vulnerable people is to make sure that we listen and then tailor services to meet their needs. And when I talk about services, I'm not just talking about mental health and wellbeing services here. We need to take a completely different approach across services to get this right for individuals. And this is the most important thing that we need to do, one of the most complex things. But I think by working together in that holistic way and creating a greater understanding of people's needs, we can do it.
Craig Hoy, to be followed by Evelyn Tweed.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. While the strategy makes passing reference to rural issues, will Mr Stewart commit to a specific suicide prevention plan for farmers and gamekeepers? And will he support the British Association for Shooting and Conservation's proposal for a gamekeepers task force to better understand the significant mental health challenges faced by this group?
Minister.
Presiding Officer, as I explained earlier, we are going to look at different sectors. We recognise that suicide is more prevalent in certain work groups. And I know that there has been a fair amount of work on these issues by the likes of Support and Mind Scotland. My mind is not closed to any suggestion around about these particular issues. What I would say to Mr Hoy and other colleagues, we don't want to fragment things too much in terms of our approach, but at the same time, I'm more than willing to look at anything that we need to do to create better protections and safeguards for sectors, whatever they may be. And I'd be happy to speak to Mr Hoy further on this issue if he wants.
And Evelyn Tweed.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I recently met with pupils from a local school in Stirling who raised concerns about mental health provisions for young people. Can the Minister advise how the Suicide Prevention Strategy and Action Plan will be rolled out to ensure young people in my constituency are supported?
Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And the new strategy will go further in supporting children and young people affected by suicide. We know this group need different approaches. And as I said in my answer to Mr Cole Hamilton, that's why we've established that youth advisory group to help us understand their needs in greater detail so that we can develop effective responses building on our existing work, such as the Better Tomorrow social media campaign, which ran earlier this year. The action plan itself sets out a range of specific work to support new approaches to prevent suicidal behaviour in children and young people. And this will focus on key settings such as education, health and social care and youth work. And we'll work with partners to develop existing and new age-appropriate resources for inclusion in the school curriculum, which will build on the understanding of mental health, self-harm and suicide prevention. And all of this will be evidence-informed.
Thank you. That concludes the ministerial statement. The next item of business is consideration of business motion 6456 in the name of George Adam on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau setting out a business programme. And I call on George Adam to move the motion.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm moved.
Thank you, Minister. No member has asked to speak on the motion. The question, therefore, is that motion 6456 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed. The next item of business is consideration of Parliamentary Bureau motion 6457 on approval of an SSI. And I ask George Adam, on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau, to move the motion.
And moved, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. The question on this motion will be put at decision time. There are 7 questions to be put as a result of today's business. And can I remind members that if the amendment in the name of Humza Yousaf is agreed to, the amendment in the name of Sandesh Gulhani will fall. The first question is that amendment 6437.1 in the name of Humza Yousaf, which seeks to amend motion 6437 in the name of Jackie Bailey on supporting the NHS in winter, be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The Parliament is not agreed. There will be a short suspension to allow members to access the digital voting system.